Hello everyone, in this video we will present the scientific evidence that proves the sphericity of the Earth. Let's get started and don't forget to subscribe and like. We will begin with the first philosopher who accepted the idea of a spherical Earth, the Greek philosopher Pythagoras, around 570 BCE. He observed that the moon appears as a sphere at night, and the sun also takes the shape of a sphere. So why wouldn't the Earth also be a sphere? This was the first belief in the Earth's sphericity in a world that largely believed in its flatness. And around 350 BCE, the philosopher Aristotle stated, "Since everything falls toward the Earth itself must be resting on something. The only shape in which all parts fall toward a single point is the sphere." This statement was made more than 2,000 years before the discovery of gravity. Due to Aristotle's fame at that time, many people followed him and accepted the idea of a spherical Earth. Around 250 BCE, the Greek scholar Eratosthenes heard that the sun was directly overhead in Aswan at a certain time, meaning there were no shadows at all in the city. This made him think, if the Earth were flat, then when the sun is directly overhead in Aswan, it should also be directly overhead in Alexandria at the same time. To test this, he placed a stick in the ground in Alexandria and was surprised to find that it cast a shadow at an angle of 7.2 degrees. He then reasoned, since the sun is far from the Earth, if the Earth were flat, its rays should hit both cities at the same angle. However, since a shadow appeared in Alexandria while none appeared in Aswan, the Earth could not be flat, it had to be curved. The curvature of the Earth caused the shadow to form at different angles in different locations. But Eratosthenes didn't stop there. Having accepted the Earth's spherical shape, he decided to calculate its circumference and diameter. He deduced that since the shadow angle between Aswan and Alexandria was 7.2 degrees, if we were to draw a line from Aswan to the Earth's center and another from Alexandria to the Earth's center, the angle between the two lines would also be 7.2 degrees. According to the rule of alternate interior angles, when two parallel lines are intersected by a transversal, the interior angles are equal. Using this method, Eratosthenes determined that the two cities were separated by an angle of 7.2 degrees. All he needed now was to measure the distance between them. He hired a man to measure the distance between Alexandria and Aswan, and the man reported that it was 5,000 stadia. The stadion was an ancient Greek unit of measurement, with 1 kilometer equaling approximately 6.34 stadia. From this, Eratosthenes calculated that an angle of 7.2 degrees corresponded to 789 kilometers. Using a proportion, he estimated that the full 360-degree circumference of the Earth would be approximately 39,450 kilometers. From this, he derived the Earth's diameter as 12,570 kilometers. These numbers were remarkably close to the actual values. Earth's circumference is 40,075 kilometers, and its diameter is 12,742 kilometers. However, flat Earth believers at the time objected to his conclusions. They argued that his calculations were based on the assumption that the sun was far from the Earth and that its rays should be parallel. But what if the sun were actually small and very close to the Earth, positioned directly above Aswan at that moment? In that case, its rays would strike Alexandria at an angle, naturally creating a shadow. This counterargument was logically sound, as Eratosthenes had merely assumed that the sun was far away without proving it. Between 230 and 310 BCE, the astronomer and mathematician Aristarchus set out to prove that the sun was far from the Earth, thereby confirming Eratosthenes' theory that the Earth was spherical. At that time, it was already known that a solar eclipse occurred when the moon passed between the Earth and the sun, while a lunar eclipse happened when the moon moved into the Earth's shadow. From this, Aristarchus deduced two very important facts. Since the moon moves between the Earth and the sun must be farther away than the moon. Since the moon disappears into the Earth's shadow, the moon must be smaller than the Earth. Based on these insights, Aristarchus decided to calculate three things: the diameter of the moon, the distance from the Earth to the moon, the distance from the Earth to the sun. To determine the moon's diameter, Aristarchus waited for a lunar eclipse and measured how long it took for the moon to disappear completely behind the Earth's shadow. He found that it took 1 hour for the moon to fully enter the shadow and 2 hours for it to remain hidden before reappearing. Since the shadow the moon was hiding behind was actually the Earth's shadow, Aristarchus reasoned that the Earth's diameter must be twice that of the moon, given that the moon remained hidden for twice as long as it took to enter the shadow. Using Eratosthenes' calculation of the Earth's diameter, Aristarchus estimated that the moon's diameter was about 6,285 kilometers. With this, he completed the first task. Next, he calculated the distance from the Earth to the moon. He waited until the moon was in its full phase, a full moon, took a coin, and moved it between his eye and the moon until the coin perfectly covered the moon's disk. By doing this, he created two similar triangles. One formed between his eye, the coin, and the moon. The other formed between his eye, the coin, and the distance to the moon. What does it mean for two triangles to be similar? It means that their corresponding angles are equal, and their corresponding sides are proportional. Using basic trigonometry, Aristarchus set up a proportion. The diameter of the coin slash the distance from his eye to the coin equals the diameter of the moon slash the distance from his eye to the moon. Since he already knew the diameter of the coin, the distance from his eye to the coin, and the moon's diameter, from his previous eclipse calculations, the only unknown value was the distance to the moon. Using a simple proportion, he calculated that the distance from the Earth to the moon was 200,000 kilometers. This completed his second task. Finally, Aristarchus calculated the distance from the Earth to the sun. You may be familiar with the moon's phases. It goes from a new moon, completely dark, to a full moon and then back to a new moon again. During the first quarter phase, the moon forms a right angle with the Earth and the sun. At this point, both the moon and sun are visible in the sky around sunset. The same occurs in the third quarter phase, but at sunrise instead. Aristarchus used this moment to draw a right-angle triangle with the Earth as one vertex, the moon as another, forming a right angle, the sun as the third vertex. He measured the acute angle at the Earth and found it to be 87 degrees. Then, he took the cosine of this angle, which was 0.05, or 5%. The cosine function in this case represents the ratio of the distance from the Earth to the moon to the distance from the Earth to the sun. Distance from Earth to moon slash distance from Earth to sun equals 0.05. Since Aristarchus had already calculated the Earth-moon distance as 200,000 kilometers, he used a simple proportion to determine the Earth-sun distance. Earth-sun distance equals 200,000 kilometers slash 0.05 is equal to 4 million kilometers. This result demonstrated that the sun was much farther from the Earth than flat Earth proponents claimed. It also confirmed Eratosthenes' theory that the Earth was spherical. However, modern measurements show that the actual Earth-moon distance is 384,000 kilometers, not 200,000 as Aristarchus calculated. This error arose because he did not account for the fact that during a lunar eclipse, the Earth's shadow has a faint outer region, the penumbra, meaning that the fully dark portion does not represent the Earth's full diameter. Due to this mistake, all subsequent calculations contain some degree of error. In reality, the Earth-Moon distance is 0.2% of the Earth-Sun distance, not 5%. Thus, the actual distance from Earth to the Sun is 150 million kilometers, not 4 million. Despite these errors, Aristarchus' achievements were extraordinary. Using only basic tools and his intellect, he was able to estimate vast cosmic distances and provide strong evidence for the Earth's spherical shape, an incredible feat for his time.
Thus, we have seen how ancient scientists did not rely on mere speculation but used observation, experimentation, and mathematics to uncover the secrets of the universe. From Pythagoras to Aristotle, and from Eratosthenes to Aristarchus, each of them contributed in different ways to proving the Earth's sphericity, despite the challenges and objections they faced. And although some errors appeared in their calculations due to the primitive tools of their time, these discoveries were a great leap in the history of science and paved the way for the scientists who came after them. Thanks you for watching. Don't forget to like and subscribe to our channel.